again, I've already recognized Dawson Community Meetings as our main sponsor, and we're so grateful for them having been on board for so many years. But also, to make this event possible, we have this year Dawson County Office of Tourism and Development Chamber and Care for Kids, which is a kind of contribution of their state and some of their equipment. Keep Dawson County Beautiful and the resources that they have as well are in kind. Mac Ever Signs, who does all of our signages, banners, everything that we do for the event, he does those in kind. Northside Hospital for South is one of our big sponsors, and they do make a financial contribution for the event. Town of Construction, which is Cathy County, he donates all the porta potties for the event, all the lighting for the offsite locations, he donates that, as well as the property part of those cars on. Chick-fil-A Dawsonville, they're a big sponsor, they feed all of the vendors, all of the volunteers, all of the staff that work the event. Dawson County Schools, for all their resources they allow us to use. Secure Lock Storage is new this year as a sponsor for the event. Advanced Disposal provides additional dumpster service for us and pickup, as well as the disposable trash receptacles. And then, of course, Thunder 104.3 has a lot of advertising in kind for us on their radio station. So we're thankful to all of those sponsors that we are able to count on year after year, because without them, this event would not be possible. To pull this event off every year, it takes about six months of planning. We start as soon as we come back from our Christmas break, right after the day, and we start planning spring sports opening day and Easter and then all the other activities that go on, but we start planning this event. And it literally takes about 6 months of pulling all of the pieces together to pull this off because of the size of the event. The people that are involved at the government level and the departments that are involved at the government level, all these folks that are listed up here, this event wouldn't happen without any of them. If one group pulled out, wasn't available, this event would not, we couldn't do that. Of course, Dawson County is fortunate and blessed to have a great staff, and they work diligently doing what's necessary to maintain the facilities and program and coordinate and pull all these pieces together. Dawson County Sheriff's Office for all of their traffic control they do for the event. Fire and EMS, that command post, all their staff that they put on site to keep us safe and protected from the event, during the event, and also the requirements of the permitting process. And then, of course, Dawson County Public Works Department and David and his, all his public work folks that put out signs for us, they mow the grass and cut the shoulders. They're there the night of the event, they put the signs out, they're there the night of the event to take them all back up. So once it's over, James Talbert and his staffing that parking area down there on the Bennett County property and getting it ready for to park cars on. And then, you know, the few employees that we do have volunteer. This year, if you recall last year, we had to cancel the event about 7, well, the rain started about 7, about 8 o'clock, we had to stop everything. We got hit with a violent storm that was not even on the radar. It just blew up out of nowhere. And we had lightning bouncing all over the place and rain blowing sideways, and it was crazy. And we thought at first it was just going to be one of those 10-minute deals and it was going to go away and we were going to be fine. That didn't happen. It lasted until about 11:30. So we had to cancel last year's event. Everything was pushed to this year. All the resources, all the planning, all the sponsorships, everything was pushed to this year, and we were very excited about that. But we've been monitoring the Access North Georgia long-range forecast for about 30 days now, just so you'll know, daily. And within the last week, it's gotten almost hourly we're watching it, so it's got us all pretty stressed out about the event and the predictions of the forecast for tomorrow and the rain that it's expecting. It's not looking favorable. The forecast has been all over the place today, but the most recent update I just got from Bill Thurman, and I want to thank him and his folks for keeping us in the loop and keeping us updated. It looks like between 3 and 9 tomorrow that we're going to be in the midst of a vicious cycle. So it's not looking favorable. But the plan for tomorrow is by 12 noon to take all of the information that we can gather through Billy and our local resources and the county managers, meet and discuss what people are going to cancel or not. Because we need to let the fireworks folks know, we need to let the vendors know, we need to let the children's activity people know, if at all possible, by noon tomorrow. So we're going to make our best judgment call at noon tomorrow, utilizing those resources. In the event we have to cancel, of course, we have to all of the media outlets that are available to us, also web postings, email, Facebook. We have a weather line. We have a rained out texting service that we use. So hopefully through all those resources, if we have to cancel tomorrow, we'll be able to communicate that information to the public in a timely fashion. The postponement date for this year, you might say, why is it August 30th? Well, one reason it's August 30th is that's the Friday night that kicks off the Labor Day holiday weekend. And we're not competing with any other shows on that night either, so it would probably turn out to be a very large event. But the primary reason is our backup date is Friday for this event. If it doesn't happen on July 3rd, in advance we say, okay, we want to do it on July 5th. Well, the forecast is much the same for July 5th. We don't want to tie up all these resources for this holiday week for 2 days and have to cancel again on Friday. So we elected to go with this August 30th date and hope that it would be not only a community event, but maybe even a North Georgia event because of the lack of other shows that we'd be competing against. You may ask why Lumpkin County has postponed their show till Saturday. We even discussed that with the fireworks provider. But that wasn't an option to us because all of their other shows wanted to postpone until Saturday. So they just couldn't pull them all off on Saturday. We could have possibly done Sunday night, but again, it was getting too late into the weekend. So we opted for this choice, and August 30th will be the backup date. Here's just some pictures from previous events that we've had. Just tell the size of the crowd on a good night. It's pretty large. Again, just a shot of the event site. And, of course, we'd like to ask everybody to please join us on tomorrow night. Weather permitting, of course, and you just never know who you might see out there.
Where did you get that?
We keep that around, Jeremy Burr, just for things
like this. I'm very glad you didn't put that
one. I guess you're right.
Are there any questions, so please help me answer.
I think you need to emphasize again that taxpayer dollars might use for this. This is totally out of the way. It's hard county employees. And all the people who donate, so it's a gift to
the county. Sure. Wonderful, long-standing sponsors that help us monetarily.
Well, a lot of employees spend their extra time. We certainly appreciate
it. Tie up their holiday weekend and have dance plans and all sorts of things. Yeah.
Any questions? Lisa, thank you. Appreciate it. Hope everything goes okay.
Well, we do too. Thank you very much. We'll keep y'all posted on the topic. You know.
Thank you. And after we stand, we'll have a brief prayer and a pledge. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Board of Commissioners, for citizens in attendance tonight as they watch government in action. Our prayer is for safe passage for Julie as she goes about what she is doing. As always, protect those that protect us both here and overseas in your name and prayer. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Board, have any announcements? Any? All right, under approval of minutes. I know that we have some folks that were not, board members that were not here for the minutes from the past. I'm not so sure that we have a contingency here that could vote tonight on any of the minutes. I think we're two and three are okay. One was not. So we'll postpone one until the voting session. Is there a motion to postpone? Is there a motion to postpone the minutes of June 20th?
Mr. Chairman, I so move.
Thank you.
Second.
Second by Mr. Shine. No discussion. All those in favor, please vote. And it's approved to postpone. Now for the minutes of June 20th.
Chairman, I move approval.
Motion approves or second? That's for lack of a second. we will, is there a motion to postpone to, so that, June, July the 6th?
Next voting meeting.
20th? Is that July the 20th, next voting meeting?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second, no discussion, please vote. And that's approved. And now the minutes of the special call meeting held on June the 27th. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the minutes as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. There's a motion and second. No discussion. Please vote. And that's approved. Thank you. Now, approval of the agenda. The agenda has no changes in it. Is there a motion to approve?
Chairman, I move approval of the agenda as offered.
Motion by Mr. Shawn, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Handy, no discussion, please vote. We have public comment for the agenda. Let me speak to that just a second. As you'll note on the agenda listing, we give 3 minutes per person, maximum 15 minutes. You must have signed up 5 days in advance to speak on agenda items. I know that there are folks here that want to speak on the Wax Mill Bridge. And we have somebody listed, Cathy Holcomb. Where are you, Cathy? Back there. Okay, Cathy wants to speak on it. We're going to allow that. If you would, though, please, because we do have that rule about signing up in advance. We'll let Cathy speak for the group of you and hope that everything that she says will be encompassed in what you would say. I will let you stand at the end of that to show that support for what Cathy has to say. Excuse me. So that the board can see how many people are here to support what Cathy has to say. So Cathy, we need you, by the way, to sign up. There's a sheet there and put name and address and name and address. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you hear me okay?
Absolutely. That's all yes.
I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to speak on behalf of Dawson County residents and taxpaying citizens located near the bridge on Black's Mill Road. If the bridge on Black's Mill Road is closed down, safety can be an issue because police and ambulances will have further distance to travel when tragedy strikes. Homeowners' insurance will increase because emergency services will be further away, causing premiums to go up. Not sure if you took this into account. The firehouse on Dawson Forest Road is within the 2 mile radius. However, if insurance policies record the closest facility at 7 to 10 miles away, homeowners will be expected to pay more. And I realize the fire truck does not go across the bridge, but it is stated in our policy that the fire department, you know, the safety vehicles are within 2 miles. Wildwood Court is a private road owned and maintained by the residents. We have allowed as a courtesy the Dawson County School Bus to turn around on our street for over 20 years, never asking for maintenance or upkeep on the entrance. Black's Mill Road will need extensive reconstruction and require the county to purchase additional land so the bus can safely turn around. Residents on Wildwood Court travel to and from work and cross the bridge to get to their destination. In fact, one resident drives a Dawson County school bus and has to travel the bridge 4 times a day so she can get her students to and from school in a timely manner. With boats, tractors, and extended trailers owned by residents, it is necessary to travel the bridge to enter and exit Wildwood Court. The turn from the other side of Black's Mill Road is too sharp and at an angle that makes turning impossible. In 2012, a travel counter was put in place at the bridge. How can the number 150 be accurate when the counter was taken up after only 16 to 18 hours, as noted by one resident, was observed by one resident? With one property owner having her house for sale, the closing of the bridge will surely lower the value of her home because of limited access. All home values will decrease as well. Unless I'm mistaken, it appears that the county would basically be giving Mr. Cravenger his own paved and county-maintained driveway, furnishing a private access to his business. So we are questioning that. Please hear our cries about closing the bridge on Black Mill Road, as it will affect many taxpaying citizens in countless ways. Are there any questions?
We asked questions. Thank you, Cathy.
Okay.
Appreciate that. And as I mentioned, those in attendance and support Cathy's views, please stand so we can see you.
Thank
you. There we go.
Thank
you. Thank you very much. We appreciate your attention. Sorry if you signed up for 5 days in advance, but
I appreciate it. I didn't know about till it was in the paper today.
All right. I think the rest of the discussion, hold on a minute, the rest of the discussion is Calhoun Creek, and we're going to start with Scott Cole. Scott.
Thank you.
And again, Scott, please name and address.
Chairman, Commissioner, my name is Scott Hall. I'm with Holcomb Smith, represent the Georgia Reservoir Company in its pursuit of the Calhoun Creek Regional Reservoir Project. Come here tonight to the opposition of the proposed resolution opposing Dawsonville's pursuit of the Calhoun Creek Reservoir Project. It is, I guess, earlier this week or early last week, provided to the board additional information that was supplied to GBA and its consideration of the project. I tried to reach out to a number of you several times in the interim without success on a number of occasions. But the situation we find now is Georgia Reservoir Company has been looking at Calhoun Creek Regional Reservoir Project since 2009, when Judge Maxine's ruling came out and said that no more works would be withdrawn from Lake Lanier. We talked with a number of communities up until 2011, when the 11th Circuit reversed that ruling. There was a lot of interest, and we were moving forward with the project with a number of sponsors. When the urgency left the project, at that time, people took a step back, decided to look at it again, We have recently, just in the last year, secured the city of Dawsonville as a sponsor for the project. They have signed up to allow the project to move forward, to start the permitting process, to evaluate funding options, to pursue funding options. With the city of Dawsonville, we have submitted surface water withdrawal applications to the Georgia Environmental Protection Division. As part of those applications, we have fully prepared yield studies that show that this project has a sustained yield of 47.5 million gallons a day. We are the only large project in the area that has taken the steps to do the engineering studies to fully vet the yield. This is a project that is concerned that it might compete with the Russell Creek project that the Water and Sewer Authority is proposing. This is more of a regional project and have regional participants in it, whereas the Russell Creek is more of a local project. So we don't see that there's a lot of competition, necessarily competition with that project. As part of the GEPA process, what we've done is apply for funding through the Governor's Water Supply Program that's being administered by GEPA and DCA. We have submitted an entire package of information. The project will be fully vetted both on a need basis and the application for funding. And that decision will be made later this year. We think at this point for this board to offer a resolution in opposition to the project is premature. GEPA is still moving through the vetting process. DCA will be meeting later this year to award a great state investment that we hope that it will award in order to put purchase some of the land associated with the project. With that in mind, I'm open to any questions that you may have. I do ask that you not vote in favor of the resolutions being proposed.
Thank you, Scott. I appreciate that. You did mention that Jeep was still looking through that, and I read comments from the mayor that it was not. So you're telling us that that's still going on, that the mayor was incorrect in that statement?
The mayor was incorrect in that statement. And the process is still ongoing. We've had recent conversations with Jeep about the project and what our goals are with it. We do understand, and I think the mayor is reading between the queues, that there are a number of projects that are seeking the same type of funding that we are for this project. But the competition is fierce for this project, that many of the projects that are seeking this funds are further along in the permitting process than this project is. And so it was a taste of realistic expectations, perhaps it was not stated in the best possible
way. I'm just curious. Thanks, Scott. Appreciate it. All right, next is Katie Klemenchich. Is that right? Did I pronounce that right?
Klemenchich.
I'm sorry. And we need to do the same thing. Name and address, please.
The place that we call Auraria is very important to a lot of people. It's sacred to a lot of people. The Indians have lived there for hundreds of years. The Trail of Tears started there, first gold rush. We would like it to see have a historic designation. We'd like to see that land bought and then protected. The question of a reservoir is something that a lot of people are not interested in having, especially old-timers. The late George David, the late Hoyt Scarborough, I've spoken to both of their daughters, several daughters of George David, who've signed the petition, and Angela Scarborough, the youngest daughter of Hoyt. They are strongly opposed to the reservoir. They also believe their fathers would be. We saw what happened at Lake Lanier last year. We saw the deaths, we saw the accidents, we saw the loud noise. We need to have places that are not changed. We need to not change every beautiful place. A dam and a reservoir not only trample upon our way of life, which is natural, but those of the animals and the fish. It would trample upon our rights to live the way we want to live, the way we chose to live, and which is why we live here. Reservoirs are not natural. Natural is why people visit here as well. We cannot live without the natural world. To slowly obliterate it means self-destruction. The animals don't deserve this. The fish don't deserve this. We want Auraria to stay the way it is, and furthermore, we'd love to see it protected eventually, and that's what we're working on. We will eventually submit petitions to the Dawsonville City Council and the Lumpkin Board of Commissioners. We have over 300. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. And last on our list is Tim Anderson.
Opportunity to speak. I represent my dad who owns 40 acres of land we're trying to take. My grandparents bought it in 1932, passed to my dad in 1974. This land is in Lumpkin County, with the city of Dawsonville was trying to take it, which I don't even have an option to really miss the people that run the city of Dawsonville. We were first approached in the fall of 2010 but it wasn't by George Reservoir, it's by Lincoln Timber. It's my niece's in the reservoir. But my grandfather, several great uncles, and I knew out that they went after timber because they didn't ask the right questions. So anyway, Ross Dawson, who introduced this bill, said that it simply gives cash strapped local governments another financing option to move forward on projects. But that's not the case here. The government didn't go looking for the company. The company came looking for government. They looked for Scythe, Pumpkin, and y'all, I don't know. The city of Bonnie, they all got turned down. So now they've come to Dawsonville. This reservoir has been mentioned. It's about 3 or 4 miles from Russell Creek. And the watershed is, you walk across 136 and you've gone from one to the other. Out of one hollow to the next, they're that close. One thing is, they say the reservoir is 500 acres. I haven't heard anybody say how big the total project is. This, a lot of this land is the old Williams Brothers Lumber Company land, which is about 1,245 acres. It's all Calhoun Creek and adjacent to it. In an advertised article from August 17, 2011, it says George Butler stressed that the consortium was not interested in peripheral land acquisition, only the land needed for the actual reservoir and buffer. Later in the same article, it says that he told the joint meeting group that the people whose land had to be taken in full would be given a right of first refusal to purchase land on the resulting lakefront, which is, and it doesn't seem we should have it both ways. We do know that it has been suggested to people that if you'll sell, you will be given the right of first refusal. So, doesn't seem like you're going to do a deal with me. They take you in and let you buy some back. And 1,245 acres is owned by 3 different groups. The Emory Air is on 375 acres. Hills Gold Creek owns 227 acres. Matter Trace owns 642 acres. Hills Gold Creek and Matter Trace operate out of the same suite in Lawrenceville. And they have another company, Low Water Realty, which is handling the earnest money in these contracts. And if the property closes, the money goes to Matter Trace, the earnest money. And if it's terminated, the money goes to Matter Trace. That doesn't really make sense to me why they would be involved in it. And I don't think any taxpayer money should win any of this. This looks to me like somebody wants to make money, which I think anything is people want to make money, but we're trying to take our money to do it. We don't want that. The land is not for sale, never been for sale. I don't have any intention of ever selling it. They could have sold this land, I don't know how many times in the last 4 years. You can get letters every week or two. Somebody wants to buy this land, some real estate company wants to sell this land, and he don't care about the money. He's 85 years old, what's he going to do with it? He doesn't even remember not his family not owning that land yet. And they said at the, when we were talking at the Dawsonville City Council meeting, they said that there'd be a 4 mile pipeline from Chesapeake to Edgewall. And Mr. Cole said that the project wouldn't work without Chesapeake. So are they going to take land all the way to the Chesapeake River? Pipeline, you got pump water across the Orary Ridge, that'll be pump stations, power lines. And so this just doesn't seem to me like this is a worthwhile thing to do. And I would appreciate y'all approving the resolution. And I thank you for the opportunity to speak. Those of you know me, I'm not much of a talker, so that's good.
Appreciate it. All right, that ends public comment. We'll now get into the body of our meeting tonight and go to new business. First piece of new business, approval of 2013 Emergency Local Maintenance and Improvement Grant. That's the LMIG grant. Headley and Corey presented that to us last week in a list. Is there any more information needed? Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the 2013 Emergency Local Maintenance Improvement Grant application.
Thank you, Mr. Swafford. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Sean, discussion? Discussion? Hearing none, please vote. And it's approved. Next is the approval of the selection of Black's Mill Bridge Alternatives Plan. And I think we had some additional information. Corey, David, did we not?
Yes.
All right. Can you come forward and give us any other information we have not?
Thank you, Chairman. Commissioners, first of all, I want to provide just a couple clarifications from last week's meeting, and that was that we stated that the Cleveland Bridge did not receive a sufficiency rating from GDOT. And I have some pictures that I want to show you, but I got these pictures are kind of give a comparison of what the, functionally obsolete and what is sufficiency rating, would be for GDOT.
And the point here is last week we had some questions about GDOT and their ratings. We were a little confused about what those ratings meant. I think you're here to help us understand that.
Yes, sir. GDOT did get a rating of 76.97 rating for the Cleveland Bridge. That was done in 2011. There was a 19-point reduction on that bridge, which I'll show you in a minute, due to the fact that it is a single-lane bridge, which we were dealing with on Black's Mill. That one-lane, GDOT considers that to be a functionally obsolete bridge. The board had asked, when repairing the bridge, make it safe or increase the sufficiency rating. Clarifying that, repairing the bridge would bring it up to an acceptable sufficiency rating by GDOT, not so much a safe rating. There's other regulatory agencies such as ASHTO or TCD that have criteria that would make it considered to be safe. So what they look at is sufficient rating, and that rating, varies. So this particular bridge here, this is Holcomb. And we replaced this bridge last year, actually it was 2 years ago now, with box culverts. This is a two-lane, used to be a one-lane, as you can see here. It was a one-lane bridge that was listing on one side and was replaced with the culverts in the two-lane road. Has ample signage, has ample guardrails. It's all in compliance with both GDOT regulations, ASHTO, and NDTCD. What we look at now is going down to Cleveland Bridge and seeing single lane bridge, which is similar to what we're talking about on Black's Mill. We replaced that bridge about 3 years ago. Gives you an idea of what we're talking about here. It's an IB steel structure bridge with concrete deck, side rails, and everything, which is compliant with GDOT, but doesn't meet all the other requirements that make it a safe bridge. So sufficiency and safe is, determines on which agency you're talking. GDOT doesn't like to use safe rather than sufficient. So, on July the 7th, GDOT will be back out to do an inspection on the Black's Mill Bridge. That's going to be next week. They'll have from that till the 13th, till the 7th of August to go ahead and rate that bridge again. And talking with them, and going over what was deficient in 2009 versus 2012, the deficiencies that they noted was that the decking sufficiency rated between 0 and 9 got 5.
As it stands.
Which is a fair to for a rating on that. The substructure has three beams that replacement, which is what they call sweeping occurring, needs a lateral support. It's where depending on the level where it goes, how you would brace that up in order to, not weaken or.
And so
create a situation.
And so the point of construction would not necessarily be the replacement of the beams, but rather the bridging of the beams so that they didn't sweep?
Part of it, yes. That would be part of it, exactly. The substructure increased washing under the abutments, and then the average daily traffic has increased, from
window to the original one in 9 to when they did it in 11. So you did have an increase in traffic, you did have a deterioration in those areas. It's definitely deteriorating, but the substructure was deteriorating, you know, recommending the driver. So that was the difference in the two reports.
And to the point of what we heard about 16 hours versus 24, what's your time frame for county traffic? Is it 24 hour period?
Roughly, I mean, it depends on the type of the road that you're on. You know, if we were on 400 versus, you know, a rural type road or connector or that type of road, it just depends on what it was. We took a Thursday and Friday account, just to get an idea, basic idea of what was going through.
Full through or Thursday for a period of time and Friday for a period of
time? For a period of time.
To collect a 24 hour count, it has to be counted for at least 24 hours. So, right? And but there are adjustments that can be made given the time of week. There's a lot of calculations that can be added through other scientific studies that make adjustments whether or not it was school in or out. And then, so the traffic data that was collected is accurate data. It's not to say we could collect it again today and be slightly different. So.
So anyway, GDOT was recommending for the sufficiency rating to increase. They were recommending that three of the beams be replaced. Clean paint other beams, which was a total of 7 beams, and replace the deck, install guardrails, and short the eroding slopes. Again, this is all part of the clean right, but just to give you an idea of the bridge itself. Now here's Wax Mill. We go down here, this is the understructure there, where you see the I-beams and the abutments there. This was the sign, I believe, that somebody had taken down. It was posted at a 5-ton weight limit that has been taken down. This is the approach coming from Dawson Forest approaching the bridge. So you can see the planks and the beams that are supported underneath starting from the road away. This is the I-beams underneath that twisted into the load of what's this one here. Some more of the understructure there. And this is the side where you can see the erosion taking place around. The abutments themselves, you know, are intact, but it's the outside areas that are starting to erode away and are starting to go down.
And the abutments, the spans themselves go into the hard rock.
Yes, sir.
So regardless of corrosion, they're in solid. Is that correct?
The bridge is staying with the road.
Okay.
I mean, that's what I'm saying on the side slopes there. The beams make sense, but we made it just, you know, the side.
Yeah. I guess the point I'm trying to get to is sufficiency versus safety. You want to make sure when you report that something doesn't fit the criteria, that it's still a safe bridge.
Yeah.
It's just that under certain GDOT specifications, they have a different way of looking at it.
They did. And in their comments to us was that in the future you'll see probably the sufficiency will go away and it will go to load limits.
Sure. So you said the sign is gone?
Pardon?
The sign, the 5-ton sign is gone?
All right, it's down.
Because it was there 2 weeks ago.
No, it wasn't.
No? I thought I saw some of that waiting sign.
It's been knocked over.
For a while?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Anyway, with those repairs, the rating could be adjusted upward to a sufficiency rating of 67. Going over this with the Holcomb and saying this is what we're planning on, and that sufficient rating could go from, I believe at 12 it was 44.7, and 9 is 59.8, but 44.7 would now go up to approximately 67 if these improvements were made.
Yes, sir.
Did the same inspector do both of those?
Not to my knowledge. And that's one of the issues that we talked about as far as meeting different inspectors out there. They, like I said, they are on July the 7th, they are coming back out for a 213 inspection. They give 30 days between. So July 7th to August the 17th, we got that, and then we'll get the following report to see where they are there. But if it's deteriorated from 59 to 44, it's ours.
Question?
Yes. If the weight limit on the bridge as it exists today is observed, in your opinion and the opinion of the engineer, is the bridge likely to catastrophically fail structurally? That is, if a car drives over it, is the bridge likely to collapse and the car go into the stream?
The beams are intact, and 7 of them, according to GDOT, they don't feel like it meets the 5-ton weight limit, that there doesn't even need to be a weight limit. So the only thing that would fail would be the bridge decking on top of it. But as far as large vehicles being able to go over it today, even with pretty rough decking, it would support the load limit.
So that means that's a no. You don't think it would structurally fail. If the weight limit is observed, the bridge is not likely to structurally fail.
Correct.
Catastrophic.
That's because the abutments are sound, the beams are embedded in the abutments, so the main structure of that bridge is intact. There are 3 beams that are recommended to be replaced, but there's still 4 other beams that can help support the load.
Replace or span? Because I heard David say that they have a sway to them, which would mean that you would span them rather than replace them, or am I hearing that wrong?
3 that need to be replaced, and out of 7 that the other 4 need to have this.
Okay. Support. Yes, sir.
One other question. Are the side rails robust enough now to prevent a car traveling at the posted low speeds from leaving the bridge and falling into the creek or the old port?
I could push it over and fall in itself.
So the answer to that is they're not. So if you applied that structure, the bridge is not likely to catastrophically fail. But I think the convention in everybody's head now is that you should have guardrails sufficient to prevent a car traveling in a normal fashion from exiting a bridge. Is that not true?
Correct. And that's where we get into the difference between a sufficient bridge.
That's right. I'm trying to get away in my head because I'm thinking about liability and safety for the citizens. And so I'm trying to find to understand what it is we would need to do at a minimum on that bridge to continue to use it. I would say, just having chatted about this issue from time to time over the last couple of weeks as we've all gone down and looked at that bridge, if we decided that we were going to close the road and abandon the right-of-way and shut the bridge permanently, that would take how many hearings, Joey?
One.
Take 1 public hearing. So we're not contemplating doing that right now. Our issue, at least that I had discussed with the other commissioners, and somebody correct me if I'm wrong, is not the abandonment of the bridge in any permanent fashion, but our concern about the public safety. And that's what we're trying to get at. Do we need to close the road for a temporary period of time till we can find the funds to render the bridge safe enough that we feel good about the public using it? That's, to me, that's the nut that we're wrestling with right now.
You would have to have a separate hearing if you decided to close the bridge. Give us a mental picture of what a guardrail for this bridge would be. Is it a 400 guardrail? Is it a...
There are different options. What we chose to do on Cleveland Bridge, which we have a picture of, would be something that...
Is that wood or metal?
Metal. And the metal is fixed to the beams under the bridge, so it's a strong support. That's what you see, something similar. It may be galvanized, you know, rather than that kind of thing.
Yes.
To do something aesthetically, that would be...
I understand. Mr. Hanks.
These guardrails on this bridge are straight across, but if the arch still fails, wouldn't that strengthen the beams underneath? Put an arch, guardrail. If you arch the guardrail and tie it to the beams under that bridge, wouldn't that strengthen the rail underneath? And
structurally, it would improve the strength of the outer beam.
What if we said, okay, we want to do the minimum at this point to keep the bridge open and to keep it safe. If you said we're not faced with catastrophic failure, then the issue to me then is the guardrails. What could you do with the guardrails? Could you lay heavy beams across there and fix them to the plank so that at least you've got a slot so the slot car can't go over the edge, or would you have to come and bore big holes at the end and put a big heavy beam down each side? Is there a fix that you can do short of attaching the guardrails to the structure underneath? Is there any fix?
My structure is sound enough to accomplish what the goal is to prevent a vehicle from hitting it and allowing it to bounce off and not fall into the waterfall there. There's structurally, to make the structure sound enough, you're either going to have to come up with a piece of metal that's so stiff and strong and span the bridge. But if you affix it to the bridge decking and not the I-beams below it, then you're not going to get that strength at that connection.
Could you span the whole thing with a guardrail fixed in posts at each end as a temporary fix to keep the bridge open? And what would that sort of cost?
I think it's possible we'll have to look into that structurally, that type of span is about a 30-foot span, and I'm not aware of these
You may not know this. How long's the bridge now?
How long's the bridge been up?
Up.
It's getting through.
So we're looking at 60 something. How many folks have run off that bridge? Anybody?
No.
Anybody?
No.
Okay, so I know we're getting in the weeds with this thing. incident has not occurred.
I think we're trying to address the guardrail purposes of whether or not this is a safe bridge. If we are going to have guardrails, it would not be a safe bridge.
By the same token, those guardrails have been up for a long time, nobody's been off. So the real issue is, where do we land as far as this bridge is concerned? It's been brought to us as an aspect of one of the things we looked at, 3 years ago, I guess.
Yeah.
Got any idea what the guardrails cost?
Depending on the style that we go with, we do something that refers to a standard GI guardrail, the current prices.
I don't know.
One of the issues that I'm wrestling with in my mind is liability for the county. And so that's one of those real things you got to sort of think about. Since the 50s, my guess is that those guardrails were on that bridge since it was installed, probably were never active to keep a car within the confines of the...
Probably the guardrails were added sometime later. I bet you in the 50s, just a few years ago.
Well, the guardrails sometimes provide, instead of structural support, provide a
visual
barrier to stay away from. So that's what these provide.
They work pretty good, I'm sorry. They must have. Nobody's wrong. Other questions we've got of these two gentlemen? Great. Any additional information you can give us?
I got a question. Underneath Blacksmail Bridge, go to that picture. What is back up?
That's the question.
Long.
That's it.
No, we're not there yet. Right there. What is that pipe?
That's my pipe.
That's a pipe for the water.
It's water pipe.
It's a water pipe. Currently.
Irrigation from one area that I have plants to another.
Okay.
It's an irrigation pipe.
Is that permitted?
If we could, Mr. Chairman,
yes,
just stay on that picture one moment. The only way to put a guardrail on would be to come underneath the bridge, put a beam across those beams, and stick the guardrail up from each side, come underneath, and affix those to that beam somehow.
You could weld the guardrail to the outer I-beams.
Okay.
That's how it could work.
Again, I hope we get to a point where you decide to allow these folks to design something for safety and then come to us in the budget process and a listing process through either dollars that you got in budget 13 or budget 14, as opposed to closing it because you feel your safety issues, as opposed to having a hearing to close it. So I think you've got several options to consider there. Any other information that these folks can provide us? Thank you. All right, any other additional information of the board? Nope.
I have a motion.
We're ready for motions. Motions, please.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we leave the bridge open and that we put sufficient signs. signs down there to let the public know that this bridge does not have guardrails on the side that are sufficient to keep them on the bridge, and then we put orange barrels at each abutment so people can see that there's an issue here, and we post signs that we ask, and we leave the bridge open for now, but we highlight it as best we can with regular signs that there's a problem here. And that we ask our engineering department to go back and look at the issue at this point just of side rails, and then develop the third point, to develop a long-term plan that we could approve as the plan for the future to fix this bridge appropriately.
There's a motion on the floor by Mr. Sean. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Hamby, discussion. Hearing none, please vote. And that motion is
And y'all be real careful.
Seems like they have been for
60
years.
We have a lawsuit. And tell your neighbors to be careful.
Okay. Next is the approval of 2013-14 ACCG property and liability insurance policy renewal. You received information on that last week. Is there any other additional information needed? Motions.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the 2013-2014 ACCG property and liability insurance renewal.
Thank you, Mr. Crawford. Is there a second? Second, Mr. Hamby. Discussion. Hearing none, please vote. And that's approved. Next is the approval of a resolution to oppose the use of state or federal funds to finance Calhoun Creek Reservoir. This was postponed from June 20th, 2013 voting session. You had information for the public. Is there additional information needed? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Offer discussion.
All right.
Before we move to the vote. This resolution is narrowly drawn. Concerns three items. They're talking about the comprehensive plan, which is important for our county, and how we have not taken that into account. The issue of service delivery agreements, which are required by the state about to keep monopolistic practices from killing each other as we run parallel lines and power and everything else all over the countryside. And our opposition to the use of state or federal monies to fund the Calhoun Creek Reservoir. But there are a number of other points that if the board would indulge me, I would like to make.
It's your show.
First, the proposed Calhoun water reach area is very small, and it's not sufficient on its own to keep the proposed lake filled. That means that electrical pumps will be installed to pump water out of the Etowah River or other places. And this river is small like it is, and this is going to be expensive water as you pump it up into this reservoir. The city of Dawsonville, according to their own statements, does not need the water supply, having numerous wells already supplying their needs. Etowah Water and Sewers already has the first major withdrawal in the Etowah. It's down on a crossing of 53. You pass it every day if you come over Highway 53. Right now, it has excess treated water capacity. That cleaning and piping system should not be duplicated because of the cost to the general taxpayer. The city of Dawsonville has a contract with Etowah Water and Sewer, which it allows it to have access to clean water supplies that I just described through existing pipes already in the ground and unused. Etowah Water and Sewer has already spent money for Russell Creek, a reservoir just like the proposed Calhoun Creek, and we do not need to keep spending money to replicate the same thing. A Calhoun system will mean less water in the Etowah and less water for Dawson County. The leaders of Dawsonville have stated that they want this dam to service the 400 area, and this will continue their acts of annexation, expanding an already unrealistic boundary of the city. And I would remind the board that city looks like that. And this reservoir is right here. and it would have to include a bunch of this land being annexed into the city. And I'd say that this also presents some problems for me, because I sit as an elected official with the power to condemn land. And we've wrestled with that own power in our own county when we built this courthouse. We chose not to condemn property because we thought there was other opportunity and options to do that. I can see cases where you have to run a highway sometime where you have to condemn property. And I think you should condemn property very, very carefully. The problem with this proposed system is that the power of condemnation of private land will now pass in some degree to private interest influence, driven by the profit motive. And I think that's a very dangerous thing to have happen. If you're going to have people that have the power to condemn land, you should be within the reach of the voters and answer for your acts. Finally, if this is such a great deal, why should not the private parties write the whole check and receive the whole of the benefit? If they want it, let them pay for it. Mr. Chairman, I move adoption of this resolution.
Motion by Mr. Chown. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Mr. Swofford. Discussion? Hearing none, please vote. And the resolution is approved. Next is the approval of the rejection to annex 13-003, just for public interest. That's a piece of property on Highway 9. It is bordered on three sides by city, but it is still located as a county project. There is a request to annex circle around another piece of property that's in the middle of that creating what I think is a donut hole. And the request is we have to send a request back into the city explaining whether we approve or disapprove of that annexation. It carries very little weight other than by law we have to respond to the request for a response. So with that, is there any other information? Motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move approval of the rejection to annexation 13-001.
There's a motion by Mr. Sean. Is there a second? Yes, sir.
Correct that for the record, 13-003.
Oh, I'm sorry. 13-003, it shall be noted.
Oh, you're right.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Swofford. Discussion. Hearing none, please vote. And the approval of rejection of the annexation is approved. And next we go to the approval to proceed with additional item 3A in emergency repair of a sinkhole, contracting the amount of $118,041 to be funded temporarily from fund balance until other funds are assigned. And the information on this is that there is a sinkhole that has been repaired behind where Dunkin' Donuts will go off of 400. And in processing that at the tune of $141,000, I think, we find that the pipe is under the roadway that leads across from Nordson to where the motel is, has been impaired and needs to be fixed. So this is additional money to sleeve this particular pipe that goes under the road. The request is that it start out at fund balance, but if we can find money from LMIG or Mr. Headley's budget, that we will endeavor to do that. Any other information needed? Motions?
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve that emergency repair in the amount of $118,041.
Ms. Swofford, is there a second?
Second,
Mr. Handy. Discussion? Hearing none, please vote. It is approved. There being no other further business, we are adjourned. Thank you for your attention tonight.
For 7 days prior to the meeting. And so actually outside in the hallway may be a better location. Let me find the today's date. That's just that one right there, okay.